Today we're going to do two of the one another's. There are 30 plus in the New Testament where God commands his church to be one anothering. Specifics, and we're doing this series with it, and here's the stimulus. I read this report by Barna that said the church in North America has an image problem. And the image problem is that people perceive the church not as it's originally intended to be perceived. You see, what are we known for? What is the church known for? And when surveyed, we're not known for what we should be known for. You see, we should be known for two things, the vertical and the horizontal. We should be known for our deep, passionate, fully devoted love for God. We should be known for that. And that should be done in such a way and so compelling and attractive to other people. We should be known for our love for God. And then that in turn then propels us to be known for our love horizontal for others. That's the deal. That's biblical. That is everything. Love God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. That's what we should be known for. But all too often the church is not known for that, when we should be known for that. And so throughout the New Testament, the early church sadly wasn't known for that at most. And so the Lord needed to instruct the early church on, hey, this is how I want you to be towards one another. And in so doing, it reflects your vertical love and your horizontal love. He's encouraging us. I'm like, okay, it's good. That's what it's about. And so we're on week three of this series called It's All About You and Me. You see, church isn't just all about Jesus.
Oh, heresy.
It's not just all about Jesus. That's the vertical. It's all about one another as well, how we live out being the hands and feet of Jesus. That's what it is for. And so we started week one and I talked about encourage one another. And what does that look like? And then last week I talked about carrying or bearing one another's burdens. What does that look like? Do you know, there are people, if you woke up this morning and thought, do you know what, where can I go to get some encouragement today? Maybe here wasn't the place, you know, I don't know. But where can I go to be an encouragement? Where can I go that I may have this burden carried alongside with me? Where can I go to help bear somebody else's burdens? That's what we've done so far. Let me just give a bit of a shout out. So there's somebody here this morning that was a big encouragement to my wife a few weeks ago, and she works at Dutch Bros, and she bought my wife a Dutch Bros mug, and it's cool, and it's great, and I loved it, and I said, where's mine? You know, I know, love my wife, love me, I get it all, but I like coffee mugs. I kind of liked them, and I was like a little bit wounded. I was like, Grace Bernard, I'm like, you bought that for my wife, that's so nice, but I'm not feeling the love right now. Help me out. Friday night, she blessed me with some encouragement. I got myself these campfire mug ranges, they're just the right size, you know. They're about that like 14, 16 ounces of pure caffeine that you just need at certain times of day. So, good job, Grace. I'm just letting you know, sometimes that's all it is though, isn't it? Sometimes all it is just a little something. It's a little something. And here's the good thing, it didn't even cost her anything. She got it for free in the first place. Anyway, that's by the by. But I'm just saying, what is that like? Sometimes it's just those little things that just you go, do you know what, I just want to do that, I just want to give you this. And you don't know that's so cool. I mean, every time I drink coffee from that, I see Grace's face and go, way to go. I don't even like Dutch Bros, but that's by the by. What's wrong with that? That was a bit of a murmur. I like Starbucks. Moving on. So today we're going to do two of these one another's. We're going to cover one that I didn't fully understand till about 8 years ago. And then when I learned what it fully meant, really captured me. And it wasn't until the last few weeks that I was reminded of it again, and I've been engaging in it. And then we'll also cover right at the end, practically serve one another. Okay, but there's one before it that propels us in that direction. If you brought a Bible, turn to the book of Hebrews. If you're not familiar with the Bible, it's an Old Testament and New Testament. The New Testament's about 25 to 30% of the whole Bible. So you have a real Bible, turn to the back section to find the New Testament. And you have Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John, then the book of Acts and Romans, and then all the Ians are together, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. Start slowing down, okay? You'll see this book, it's pretty weighty. It's a book of Hebrews. Turn to Hebrews and chapter 10. So when you found the book of Hebrews chapter 10, I'm going to read verse 24, but then go back and start at verse 19 because of context and the projected momentum. So here is today's one another verse. Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 24. Oh, just so you know, it's called Hebrews because this was written to Hebrews, people who were Jewish in their culture, in their heritage, and they become followers of Jesus. The other churches, those cities in that whole Mediterranean basin, originally were Greek in culture. This is Jewish in culture, so the context of Hebrews has got to be read through that lens. It's very different. And nobody fully really knows who even penned the book of Hebrews. There's the intelligent guesswork out there. We don't know. No big deal. God inspired it. Hebrews 10 and verse 24. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Spur one another on. Now let me give the context because it comes off the back of some more verses. Start in verse 19. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, open for us through the curtain that is his body, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from the guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water, let us hold unswervingly to the hope we professed, for he who promised is faithful. So up to this point, you've got this, remember, Hebrew background, Jesus, this supreme, great high priest, supreme sacrifice. This is what he's done for you. He's made a way. No longer is God confined to the Holy of Holies, but the curtain is gone. Jesus has made the way. His body on the cross, his death, his bloodshed, his resurrection. This is awesome. And we hold unswervingly to that hope because his promises, he is faithful. We've been singing it. He is faithful. Some of you this morning think that God is not faithful. You think he's faithful to everybody else, but not you. Some of you think you've let him down, he's let you down, it's not kind of working. His promises are faithful, he is faithful, but he doesn't end it there. And let us, in response to that, consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds. There's a reason behind this. Now, spurring on is not the same as encouragement. Like, Des, you talked about this 2 weeks ago. No, I didn't. No, I didn't at all. Spurring on is different to encouragement. And so you're going to learn something today. And when I first encountered this and dived into it and studied it and learned it, and then in recent times been experiencing it, I'm like, there's a difference. Spur on means this: to urge, to get them going. What is the role of spurs when riding a horse? To get it going, you kick the horse in the butt. That's what spur on means. To give someone a kick in the rear. It means, come on. That's what it means, literally. To spur is not encourage and come on, you can do this and yeah, 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 yeah. It's like, come on. Urge them. Spur them on. There is something there. Give them a kick in the rear. Come on now. Well, here's the reason why. Spurring is always towards something. Encouragement is, I need it here. To spur on is the on. It's always towards something. It's always toward an action, toward an activity. It's causing someone to do something they are not doing. It's causing them to speed up. It's causing them to engage more. When we see in the scriptures, as iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. That's a spurring on. There's a sharpening. There's something about, oh, I'm being moved on here. This isn't an encourage one another. It's a spurring on. It quite literally means to provoke. It literally means that I can go to somebody else and it almost implies an element of discomfort for the person, but for the purpose of them moving on, for the purpose of them going toward something greater. For their benefit, there is a spurring on that is different than just encouraging. And it's significant, which is why he then goes on to say, which we covered 2 weeks ago, don't give up meeting together. There's an encourage, but there is something about spurring one another on that's important. Now, this is where about 8 years or so ago, I was engaging in this, and I heard this message by a guy called Mark Batterson, who's in DC, and he talked about it, and I went, oh, I now get it. Ta-da! And here's how he introduced it from some guy who was cleverer than him as well. Cleverer? More clever. Anyway, moving on than him. So here we go. It's all down to how you see you in spurring on. There are four quadrants to your identity that is seen. Four quadrants. Imagine a window pane and there's four sections. In one quadrant, that is about my identity, is what you see and what I see. What you see in me and what I see in me. Public. There's this quadrant that what people perceive me to be like and who I really am, and they agree. So there's that perceived, this is who I am, quadrant. There's another quadrant that is the me that I only see. The who am I when no one's looking. There's the me that nobody else sees. Only I see that. And it's different, isn't it, than this other quadrant? Because there is something that only I, that's an identity, who I only see. So who you and me see, just me. Then there's a third quadrant, and this quadrant is what other people who know me see in me, but I don't see it. It's called blind spots. Or things that I've forgotten I didn't realize. Or somebody bringing to my attention, hey, you might not realize this, but this is what's going on here. And you go, I had no idea. I didn't know that. No, it's been slowly creeping in, and now all of a sudden, you find yourself here. It's that what other people see in me that I don't see. That quadrant. And that's the quadrant that this text is all about. It's that one. The fourth quadrant is what the Holy Spirit sees in me and sees me becoming. And you think, that's the one you'll talk about. Nope. We're going to talk about this one because it's one another. Spur one another on is all about somebody coming alongside you or you coming alongside them and causing them to move toward love and good deeds, and something is causing that not to happen, preventing that. Spurring on is a kick in the butt. Provoke is a stimulus there that goes on. And nobody really like plans for it. It kind of is something that you either invite or somebody, hopefully nice, brings to your attention. Where do I need to be spurred on to love and good deeds? Where do I need that? What is coming in on me that would cause me not to live fullness of life? Where do you need to be spurred on? Who do you have in your life that can do that? Because it can't be somebody who doesn't know you. Because that'll just be criticism. Got to be somebody there is relationship with, or you've invited them into that. But it is a critical component that is needed. Really critical. Who are you able to spur on? And I want to hopefully present that in such a way that you understand maybe some how-tos of that, because some of you may have an intention of spurring on, but you are just wounding. The fine line. in all of that. So, maybe it's something you've forgotten. So in recent weeks, I have been spurred on. I initially did not start the invitation. However, having received it, I then invited others into it because I saw its value and I saw how much I needed it. And so the last kind of semester and that last 2018 took its toll, as I've shared before, and there was things going there, and I have somebody in my life who knows how to spur me on effectively. I share a bed with her, and it's my wife, by the way, anybody wants to misquote me. But it always becomes, there's a certain way, is when she feels I'm at a point where I'm kind of needing it and kind of asking for it, then she knows how to deliver it. So I had such a moment a number of weeks ago and different things, and those things kind of all there, and she just spoke into me and she said, okay, blind spot, this is what you need to do. She told me what I needed to do. Now, guys, there's a provoking by your wives that's not good, agreed? Sometimes they provoke you to other things other than spurring on. I get it. But there's a provoking at times that is because the two have become one that is healthy, and we just have to swallow that thing called pride and listen. And so she poked me and she said, okay, here's the deal. You seem to be inviting it. This is what you have not done in years. What is that? And when you did it last, it was so revolutionary, so life-bringing, so life-changing. We all loved you more for it. Get on with it. What is it? When was the last time this happened? She said, 6 years ago. I'm like, oh, you know exactly when it was. Oh, my goodness. I realized what it was. I'm like, oh, yeah. And, you know, the busyness of life became my excuse for not doing this. But she was spurring me on, and then she even said, oh, and by the way, you're going to need help this time. Great. So she told me to go and see somebody who's part of this church, and she said, oh, he'll be able to spur you on. I'm like, yeah, I know. That's going to really hurt. But I invited it. And long story short, what does it look like? It looks like this in reality. Tomorrow afternoon, I take a road trip all by myself up to Sedona, to be with nobody else but me and Jesus till Thursday afternoon, just the two of us, going up a mountain, and I will come down that mountain, maybe not with stone tablets, but I'll come down that mountain. But the last time I did something like that was 6 years ago, and it set me up with incredible health and strength to move my family from England to America. Had I not done that, I don't know. There's a spurring on and the cause. And so my wife could see deficit, blind spot. You keep doing this, dude, you are fried. I'm like, I love you too. So, but there's a spurring, but what's she causing? The causing is this, and then the guy in this church who's been then putting wheels on that and beating me with that causes me to go towards something. It's not a self-help gig. The Lord has so much for all of you. How can I go from here to there? What do I need to know and feel and decide and make sure he's super strong so I am spurred on toward love and good deeds? What is it? What's it going to take to do that? Now, we need a miracle because 3.5 days probably won't be enough for me, the state I'm in. But anyway, it's a good start. We'll get there. And it needs to become, and I'll be accountable now, to an annual thing minimum. Not a wait another 6 years until you're nearly dead. See? Now, for you, who are the people who can speak into you and spur you on, and who is in your life that you need to spur on? Here's the text that's awesome. And let us consider how. This isn't reaction stuff. This isn't, you're a loser. It's not. It's consider how. You know them. There's relationship. You think about it and you coach. You are bringing direction for a why. A coach wants you to win. A critic wants you to lose. There is something deep there, but it's a spurring on. Are you getting the feel compared to just encouragement? It's a spurring on. You see, Grace giving me a coffee cup just encouraged me, made me feel really cool. And as good as that is, keep bringing them, as good as that is, it didn't change the trajectory of my life. But spurring on really can. Really can. So, we should consider how we may. This is thinking. It's relationship. That's why we need to be alongside other people. That's why I am blessed that I had somebody who could, and my wife could then say, oh, you need to speak to this guy. The Lord had provided to move forward with that. It's not reaction, because it's all about toward love and good deeds. You see, 2019, Grace, is a year where we shouldn't be focusing on what we have to do. We should be focusing on who we need to become. For my own life, Des needs to not focus on what I need to be doing. I need to focus on who I am becoming. That's a spurring on. That's what it means. It's so good. What would it look like for Grace this year to fearlessly start to shift and transform, that we become known for the vertical and the horizontal, and the city is impacted because of it? That's a becoming, not a doing. But I need to be caused to go toward that. I wrote these things down because they're quite arresting. I wrote this down. Des, it seems to be easier for you to be right than it does to love people. Dang it. Yes, it does. I can instinctively get involved in a discussion and win the argument, but lose the person. And we sometimes focus on, but people need to know the truth in love. That's the bit you don't want to add on, isn't it? What does that mean? By declaring the truth, you're pushing them towards something that's compelling, not a pushing away. So if it's causing a push away, I want to suggest it's not in love. It's easier to be right than it is to love. I also put this down. It's easier for me to give my opinion than it is for me to love. It is easier for me to demand action than it is for me to catalyzingly cause action. You see, demanding action is, and I'll say this, so here's the case. My wife could have, I know she's not in the room right now, please don't listen to this week. She'll go, oh no, Des, stop talking about me. But she could have done this. She could have said, you are a mess, fix it or I'm out. She could have done that. And she could have had good reason to. She could have spoke that way. She could have demanded action. But she didn't. She engaged in such a way that it stirred inside me in a catalytic way that caused me to want to take action. She put enough appetizer in me to crave the entree. There was something in that. And it's not like she's like strategically, expertly trained in it. It's called love. And so I don't want to demand action. I want to stimulate, to cause people toward love and good deeds. That's spurring on. Super quick, don't have to turn to it. Proverbs 17:22 rose in my spirit one day this week. It's a really well-known proverb. It says this, a cheerful heart is a good medicine, but a crushed spirit dries up the bones. And I dwelled on it for a minute, and I thought, what is this, bones? Well, you know, bones on the external may seem dry, but not. The life of bones is in the marrow, yes? There is life. There is moisture. There is critical life-bringing chemicals in the bones. That's why people need to sometimes, for treatment, have bone marrow transplants. It's so important in the bones. So imagine a dried up bone. It's that whole physical sense of you are really in bad shape. And what causes that? It's that a crushed spirit, a broken spirit. And what causes that is the opposite of a cheerful heart, which is a good medicine. The crushed spirit, broken spirit. What are some of the things that in and around your life that are drying you out? And we, the church, should be the place where all we bring is good medicine, not a crushing of the bones. So when we just give our opinions and we're critical and we, I want, it dries up the bones. It's not who we are meant to be. It needs to be something life bringing. What if I considered how I may spur on somebody before I then go, they need to hear this. It's easier to give an opinion than it is to love. So let's consider. What if I just hit a pause and engage my brain before opening my mouth? Some of you, just a few seconds would help. For me, a lot longer. But what is that? There's something beautiful about that. Now, it says toward love and good deeds. Your dashboard should be flashing, because what did Jesus say? Jesus said, hey, church, my followers, listen, let your light shine before men that they may see your Bible study. That they may see your prayer time. That they may see you worshiping me in song. That they may see your generosity in giving. No, it doesn't say that. Let your light shine before men that they may see your good deeds. And what happens as a result? Praise your Father in heaven for it. There is a direct connection supernaturally and physically when God's people shine like stars in the universe without grumbling or complaining. There is good deeds. There is an attitude and a posture of love and good deeds that is addictively compelling to other people towards glorifying God in heaven. Jesus said, this is what I want people to see, your love for one another. A new command I give you. Do more Bible studies if I have showed you. He said, no, don't just do that. Love one another as I have loved you. By this, everyone will know who you belong to. By the way, you encourage, you carry burdens, you spur one another on. People will go, wow, that's what the love of Jesus can do. Incredible. Okay, men, I need to spur you on. If your rear feels tender in a moment, it's meant to. I feel compelled to give you a kick in the pants. Some of you are already there waiting to kick other guys in the pants, which is great. So tomorrow night, starting at 6:30 in Lamb Chapel, we have a men's discipleship class. It's a number of weeks called Real Life Discipleship. It's real life discipleship. It's not weak and wimpy and this little light of mine. It's real life discipleship with a purpose. And the purpose is this, to equip you so that you can go make disciples. We've had too long in the church when many of the guys in the church have never discipled anybody in their life. And the reason they haven't, I just don't know how. Get rid of that excuse. We'll help you with the how. You are called as a follower of Jesus to go and make disciples, to go and invest in another and to pass it on and make a difference. It's not the paid Christian's job to do it. We are here to equip God's people. And so with that in mind, tomorrow night, there's guys ready to go, to dive in, to spur you on, to go through that, to put the hard yards in, because you are called to make disciples. And so that class, tomorrow night, 6:30 in Lamb Chapel. Men, look at your schedule, clear it out. This is significant. And I know for some of you, yeah, but those you don't know, I have to work. I get it. But I'm really trying to stir you on. There's a few guys already signed up. And some of you are like, yeah, but I don't know anything about. That's the whole point. It's the whole point of all of that. Then on a Wednesday night, we have another men's gathering. It's discipleship. And that's another one. And that is led. And that's focused. And it's all to say, come on, guys. Come on. Its purpose is to spur one another on. That's also 6:30 on Wednesday night. So, hey. Here's the deal. Now, you can go sign up on the porch today for all that so they know you're coming to get ready for it. But it's really, really a big deal. And then next Sunday, just for four Sundays at the 9:45 hour, and I know many of you are planted in a class right now, I'm going to suggest to you to spur you on for 4 weeks. Don't attend your class. You belong to it anyway. You belong to that group. But for 4 weeks to engage in a class that specifically for some of you is focused this way. Some of you don't know what it is to live joy-filled lives. Some of you don't know what it is to have the Holy Spirit living and breathing in you in such a way that even in the storms of life, you can feel joyful. So there's this class for 4 weeks called The Secret of Joyful Living. And Kevin Seacat has written this material. He's been around Grace for years. It's awesome. It's next Sunday at the 9:45 hour. It's just four Sundays. But can you imagine your life now and where the Lord's wanting to get you toward? That's it. Let me go and be spurred on and have some more tools in there that I can be spurred on toward love and good deeds. So there's ways there. So it's like, oh, nobody's here to spur me on. Well, get in a spurring on environment first. And if you've got people in your life already, or maybe you need to spur on, that's awesome. Get on with it. But that's kind of, it's such a big deal. So again, you can go online and sign up for those things. You can go out on the porch and register, or you can just show up. Information's on your bulletin, on our website. But do you really want to be spurred on toward love and good deeds? So this whole series about one another is about one another. I'm going to say you cannot be a fully devoted follower of Jesus and not gather with his people. It's unbiblical. You cannot. You've got to be with his people. You have been called to become part of a family, a body, an army, a movement. How many images do you need of the body of Christ? There's a role in that, and we one another do that. Not just me. You, not just you, you and me. It's a big deal. Now, turn to Galatians 5. I want to land hard quickly on the serve one another piece and just put some practical legs on it for today because of time. Galatians chapter 5, I'm going to read from verse 13. Context, chapter 5 has been about freedom. The scriptures say it was for freedom that Christ set you free. Don't let yourself be bound up by all these rules and religious behaviors again. What are you doing? Come on now. It was for freedom that Christ set you free. And it gets pretty graphic in parts of that chapter, which we can avoid for now. So, verse 13 of chapter 5 of Galatians. This is to set you, give you context. You, my brothers, you were called to be free. But do not use your freedom to indulge in the sinful nature. Rather, serve one another in love. The entire law is summed up in a single command. Love your neighbor as yourself. If you keep on biting and devouring each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other. I'm no major expert in any comparison with the state of the church in North America, although I'm a student of it. But I could take you to England and take you to too many spaces where the church devoured each other. They devoured each other. It wasn't spiritual warfare. The enemy wasn't getting in there causing destruction. He just stood back and went, way to go. Keep at it. Off you go. I don't have to do anything. You've been awesome at being self-centered and entitled, and you're devouring each other, and you're biting each other, and you're saying, I like this, and I like that. It's just like, hey, now this gives me comfort. Because it appears that that behavior has been around the church for a long time. This was a few thousand years ago, guys. I'm like, wow. Because there is a sinful nature. The rest of chapter 5 ends up with the fruit of the Spirit. But he goes in to say, guys, this is how I want you to go. Go for it. Serve one another. There's an internal, hey, if you get this serving one another deal here, guess what? That's going to be so contagious, it'll spill right out all over the city. But you've got to, serving one another can help you love one another. Serving one another can help you spur one another on. Serving one another can help you encourage one another, can help you find out what each other's burdens are. Serving one another is amazing because Jesus was the servant king. When we serve, we become more like Jesus. So if you are not serving, you're not growing. More like Jesus. It's not a threat. It's to be like, I hadn't thought about it that way. There is something that is so powerful about that, serving others. So here's the practical. Out on the, as Melinda shared before, out on the porch today, there's a table. It's only one table with a ton of clipboards on it. It's called old school technology. And you can sign your name on a ministry area that you feel you want to get engaged in to serve. Or you can go online and go through our app and scan the QR code on your bulletin and you can sign up and get involved. But it's part of who we are. The mission of the church, the mission of grace is to engage wholeheartedly. That's the E of the word grace, which is serving. There is something about that that's important. Now, we have always, there's always room for more because we want you to grow. So maybe it is all of this technology thing that we keep going around. Hey, you're already here on a Sunday. How about serving and being part of that team? It seems complicated. We have people who can coach and train. Click buttons, plug things in, help do stuff. You can learn. It's a deal. You're already here. What if you are part of that team and going more? Some of you are so nice and smiley and encouraging and welcoming. Well, what if you were the first face that people saw when you came on campus? You are that nice. Some of you are definitely not. Don't sign up for guest services. Just you know you are. You know what I mean? You have a bad day on a Saturday. You're going to be mean. No, don't do it. You're mean. Stay away. It's okay. We'll help you. All right? But some of you have got a gift of hospitality. You know that welcoming, that so glad you are here mindset. You do not know the condition of people's soul when they walk here on a Sunday broken and desperate and they've not heard an encouraging word from anybody and you get to be somebody who like John the Baptist is and that is somebody who prepares a way for the Lord just by saying good morning and nurturing. And so you can do that. It's not a weekly thing. It's the more we'll make, if we've got too many people, you only do it twice a year, I'll celebrate that. But that's not the case right now. Our children's ministry is really growing, but it's got to such a point where at the 11 o'clock gathering, when the elementary kids arrive in that room, it is chaos. My child's in there. What are you saying? No, just it's okay. They're safe. But for some children, walking into an environment that is loud and noisy is quite scary. So the caring team there have gone, how can we make this a space and a place where each child can feel cared for and welcomed and loved straight away? Not when they've had to deal with the craziness. I know some kids love the crazy. And so they have this plan, and the plan is simply this. The terrace building is old, and it's nasty, and it's smelly in places, but we can do something about that. But they've got these side rooms that we're going to clear out so that the kids can go straight into their small group. They can be greeted in their small group with their demographic, and they can be cared for and nurtured, and then move into a bigger space to encounter something bigger. But to do that, those rooms need to be remodeled like this. The walls need painting, The carpet needs ripping up. The floors need painting. It just needs a nice sweep out and clean out and make over, put nice things in so that children can enter into the house of the Lord in a space that's just nice. You can do something about that. So if you want to paint or rip up a carpet, paint the floor, paint the walls. If you're not good at painting, don't sign up. We're going to get a work crew together. And my heart, there's four rooms that need doing. I want it done by the end of the month. It's down to, we get the manpower. You come down and you go, I could do that. And you're doing that, and all the time you're doing that, you can be praying for the children that will be in that room for years to come. All the time you're doing that, you're being John the Baptist, you're preparing the way for the Lord. And it's like a one-time deal, isn't it? So go out there, the facilities clipboard, sign up. Say, yeah, I want to be part of that. I don't know how and when. They'll figure it out. Maybe it's a Saturday. Maybe it's midnight tonight. I don't know. There'll be ways to get that on. But if that's the only thing stopping children from being planted, we can do that, yeah? I mean, the nurseries are coming on, by the way. Professionals need to do that. And they are, and it's awesome. And the frontage. We had people come to church last week for the first time, said, what brought you here? Was it our friend Google? And they were like, oh, actually not. I went, really? You're unique? What brought you here? They went, we drove past and saw that big cross. We didn't know you were a church. I'm like, oh, I was both sad and excited at the same time. So it's all good, but I'm just saying there's something for everyone to get engaged. Hey, musicians, come up. I just had an idea, and people won't be happy about it, but we've kind of got a song to end, but I'm going to add one. We've already sung it. Some of you weren't here at the beginning. We start at 11, by the way. Anyway, so just toward love and good deeds. So I've been listening to this song we did last Sunday and this Sunday, the opening song, this one called Freedom. And if you want to listen to it on Spotify, it's by Jesus Culture. You can just put Freedom, Jesus Culture. It's kind of there. But lyrically, yeah, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Scriptures, okay? It's Galatians. It's right there. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Good. I got the freedom. I'm all right now. But there's more. There's a lyric in it that's really, really good. So I'm going to say to the guys at the back, sorry about this, can we do Freedom Now? It's called Freedom, not Freedom Now. Can we do the song Freedom? And then the team can lead into Build My Life after that. But if you guys today need a good spurring on, then, you know, we have a team down here. You see, the role of praying for one another is not just comfort. It's get alongside. It's encouragement. It's carry burdens, but also part of it is spurring you on. When you pray, do you ever say, okay, Lord, spur me on? Lord, make me uncomfortable. It's been said many times before, when we gather on a Sunday, there should be a place where the disturbed are comforted and the comfortable get disturbed. Because there's so much more. So much more. So maybe today, let us help you and serve you and pray for you. But I want to lean in. I want you to know that this is about freedom, spurring on toward. I am ridiculously excited about my week ahead of me, even though there'll be work to do when I get back, because when you get an uninterrupted time with Jesus, anything could happen. And so I'm apologizing to you that it took me so long. You should be blessed that I have a wife who is freaking awesome. Anyway, stand up. Let me pray for you. Hey, men, come on now. An army of guys, disciples making disciples, that's an unstoppable force. Everybody get engaged in serving as well. Lord Jesus, I thank you that your scriptures are so arrestingly comforting. That you, because of who you are, you said, and let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. And Lord, you said that that would cause people to look to you. So Lord, we thank you for that today. We thank you we have the opportunity to serve one another, and that's a catalyst to us overflowing into our city. Be glorified, Jesus. We're going to declare now that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Lord, my desire is to see hundreds and hundreds of people encountering your freedom in this space and place, and they need to encounter your Spirit, Lord. May we be conduits of that. In Jesus' name, amen.